Good morning, everybody. It is great to see all of you here today. We are going to start worship off with some singing, so I'll invite you all to stand and join in our opening song, Open the Eyes of My Heart.
Sure to like the video, stick that on the chat, and let us know. from our congregation who will be traveling to Reynosa, Mexico in October as part of this year's Rio Brava mission team, which is made up of members from four different churches. One way you can support their work is by registering for the Stand in the Gap charity golf tournament. This annual event is taking place Wednesday, September 14th at the Fair Oaks Golf Course in Oakland. If you're not a golfer, there are opportunities to volunteer during this event. And if you own a business, check out standinthegapgolf.com to learn how you can sponsor a hole. For more info, contact Catherine Burris or speak with Pastor Kris after worship today. Our book club is preparing for it.
Is preparing to meet at the home of Pastor Kris and Alyssa Ruth in a few weeks to discuss this month's novel, The Invisible Life of Addie LaRue by V.E. Schwab. The gathering will be Tuesday, September 6th, beginning at 7 p.m. The Washington Post calls it one of the most propulsive, compulsive, and captivating novels in recent memory. Our monthly book club gatherings include fellowship, food and drink, and we finish by 8:30. You can also join our Facebook group by searching for Peace Tree Book Club to learn more about upcoming book titles and other special events. Thanks again for worshiping with us in person and online. Please stand for our next hymn, Be Thou My Vision. Right now, we're going to take a moment to offer our gifts back to God. Our ushers are walking around with the offering plates, but if you'd like to make a gift using your cell phone, please visit peacetree.church/give. If you're writing a check, please make it out to Peace Tree. Oh my gosh, Kris, I don't know why I'm struggling. I'm sorry. I've got lost. Hold up. Oh my gosh. All right. If you're writing a check, make it out to Peachtree. Okay. And if you're watching from home and you'd like to mail in your tithes and offerings, please send your gifts to 9315 East Shelby Drive, Collierville, Tennessee, 38017. Thank you so much for your generosity. Next weekend, our church building will serve as the host site for the Chrysalis Boys Flight. Chrysalis is a spiritual life retreat for young people who are freshmen in high school all the way through recent grads who may be working or in their first year of college. You may know a young person who'd like to participate in this year's flight. The boys are staying here at Peachtree and the girls will be at Collierville UMC. If you'd like to sign up your young person or you'd like to volunteer your time, then check out memphisemmaus.org or chat with Leanne Leatherwood or Pastor Kris after worship today. Now will you pray with me? Dear God, give us a vision for this school year. Allow us to be part of your mission, to address the needs of our community, and to let us dare to dream. Use the gifts of our time, energy, and this offering to accomplish your purposes on earth. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. At this time, all of our Peachtree kids are invited to join Pastor Kris on the front steps for a children's moment. Parents and grandparents, you're invited to come up with your young ones as well if they need a little encouragement. And I am done, y'all. Sorry.
Let's hear it for Jennifer, everybody. I hope you watch her. What's the weekly show with the tiny mic? Yeah,
I get to have a lot of takes.
Yeah, she gets to have a lot of takes for that. She gets to edit that. This is live, so there you go. All right. Thank you, Jennifer, for sharing with us those announcements. And hey, good morning, boys and girls.
Good morning.
Okay, so this is like you have permission to yell as loud as you would like right now. Good morning. Okay, on three. Good morning. So I should say good morning, boys and girls. One, two, three.
Good morning.
It is so great to see y'all this morning. And I know that we are wrapping up back to school series today. And I'm wondering how's your school year been going so far? Have you had a good? I got a thumbs up over here. Good so far with the school year. Yeah. Yeah, a thumbs up. Yeah, Reagan, I get to see you walk to school every morning now that you're in kindergarten. All right, Brooklyn's got some thumbs up. All right, so I know that you've been working in Peachtree Kids and you've been with Miss Karen and all of our volunteers learning about some back-to-school stuff. There was the first Sunday before school started back, we learned that God helps you to carry your worries, right? God helps you to carry your worries, and you filled up a backpack with a bunch of stuff, didn't you? I heard it got pretty heavy when you could fill up that backpack with all sorts of things. And there was a passage from the book of Psalms that you looked at. Praise be to the Lord, to God our Savior, who daily bears our burdens. Hey, can everybody repeat that after me? Praise be to the Lord,
to God our Savior,
who daily bears our burdens. And that was Psalm 68:19. And so maybe you had a lot of worries about going back to school, but I heard that the one thing that everybody had in common about going back to school, the one thing you were worried about was like not knowing anyone in your class, right? Or not having any friends that were going to be in your class when you got to that classroom and you saw all of your classmates. And now, can I tell you a secret about that? Adults have the same fears too. When we walk into a new place, or if we start a new job, or move to a new city, or do something brand new, maybe go to a new Bible study that we've never been to before, we're worried because, am I going to know anybody there? Is anybody going to be my friend? Is anybody going to sit and talk with me? Or is anybody going to, you know, want to grab lunch with me after this is done? We worry about having friends, too. Yes, Harrison, do you have a question? Like your mom? What about, what do you mean, like your mom? You mean my wife? What? Oh, yeah, like, okay, well, he has been making a very good point. She started a new job, and she was worried about having friends at the new job. I mean, thankfully, she did have some friends that were there. And like your dad, he was
scared, but I think he was
So they've moved back to Memphis, and maybe they were a little scared having to come back. Would they see their friends? I'm so glad that y'all came back to Peachtree, moved back. And so that's something that we worry about, right? Because friends are so important, and it's so important to stay connected to people and to have friends. So since you were worried about making new friends, I heard that Miss Karen worked with you for the last couple Sundays about making friends and having friends when you went to school. So I want you to raise your hand if you've met somebody new this month. Just you met someone new. Did you meet someone new? Did you meet someone new? Did y'all meet anybody new this month? All right. Now, okay, you can put your hands down. Now, raise your hand if you made a new friend so far this school year. Have you made a new friend? No? No, he said no. Haven't made a new friend yet. Have y'all made some new friends? Yes? Yes, Mac? Okay, Ashley? All right. Made some new. Now, raise your hand if you've had to deal with somebody that you didn't particularly like that much. Have y'all? Yeah. These two in middle school. All right. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So sometimes that happens too, right? We are in a class or we work with somebody that we don't necessarily like to spend time with, because it's easier to spend time with people that we get along with or we have things in common with. Like maybe you like to talk about sports, or maybe there's Pokemon cards that you want to trade, or maybe there's a show that you like to watch on TV. But we also have to remember to be nice to everybody and to the folks that maybe we don't have a lot of things in common with, because sometimes that means that we're just judging people on what we see on the outside instead of looking at this right here, right? Looking at the heart. And there was a Bible verse that y'all read from Samuel last week, and it said this: the Lord does not look at the things man looks at. Man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. And I think Miss Karen demonstrated this lesson from 1 Samuel by talking about geodes. Do y'all know what a geode is? I think we have a picture of some geodes. Look up at the screen there. You see those geodes? On the outside, if you just looked at the outer layer, it would just be an ordinary rock. But if you cut it, if you go to the inside, they're lined with all of these beautiful crystals. Right? You would never know that a geode would look like this unless you took the time to look at it, unless you took the time to go and look at what was on the inside. So boys and girls, how can we see people, these people, the classmates that you have at school, other people that you might see out and about, how can we see them the way that God sees them? How can we see someone's heart? How can we make sure that others see our hearts as well? Do you have a suggestion, Harrison?
I have something to say.
You have something to say? Okay, go. What do you want to say?
Do you eat those?
No, those are rocks. No, but there, you know what? There is such a thing as rock candy, and it could be very confusing, but please don't. Did you, you have something you want to say too?
I have my friend Tori.
Your friend, say that again?
Tori.
Yeah?
That's my friend.
That's your friend? So you made a new friend?
Yeah.
That's awesome. See, that's great. And I hope when you make a new friend, or when you make a new friend, or when you make a new friend, that we look at people's hearts, that we take time to talk to them, that we pay attention to their actions, we notice how they treat other people, and we need to make sure that we treat others the way that we want to be treated as well. So boys and girls, this school year, I hope that you won't just look at someone's outer appearance, like the clothes that they wear, or their hairstyle, or the type of shoes that they have. I hope that you'll take time to look at their hearts. Can everybody make a little heart with their hands and their fingers, right? Take time to look at other people's hearts. And this is how we can find good friends and how we can show others that we're good friends too, by showing them the type of heart that we have and finding a good heart in our classmates, in our workmates, and in our neighbors and the people around us. So boys and girls, will you bow your heads and pray with me? And boys and girls, will you bow your heads and repeat after me as well? Dear God, help us to see others' hearts.
Help us to see others' hearts.
Just like you see
our hearts. Just like you see our hearts.
Help us to make special friendships this year. And help us to live by the example Jesus set for us. In his name we pray. Amen. All right, thank you, boys and girls. Y'all can head back to your seats. Thank you, boys and girls, for praying with me as well. As they're heading back to their seats, I'll say a quick hello to those who are watching online. Let me bring up, I took a couple screenshots of this as it was happening in real time, but I think I can scroll all the way back. I was able to see Charlotte Ernesty, Liz Fernwalt, Julie Lovelady, Jamie and Celeste Giannis, Denise Scully is joining us from Byhalia. We've also got Kendall Gwaltney, who's joining us from Counts, Tennessee, Johnny Jackson, Bonnie Gay, and David Nicholson, and Gabe Lowrance, who's our hall monitor for the day, is watching out in the hallway. So that's a good thing. I'm glad that he's able to watch as well. And we do have this, we have the live stream taking place in room one, which is a cry room or just a place to go with kids if you need to. They got a table in there. They can color that live stream's in there. The live stream's in the nursery as well. So hello to all of our nursery workers and all of the adults that take care of our kids. So friends, we're getting ready for a new Bible study that's going to be led by Dr. Durbin. That's going to be starting up after Labor Day on Thursday, September the 8th. This short-term study is going to be, those participants are going to be reading Defying Gravity by Reverend Tom Berlin. If you'd like for us to order you a copy, please get in touch with us. You can email Dr. Durbin, and we can order that, have it ready for you. Our pastor's Bible study is open to everyone. It lasts about an hour, and feel free to chat with me after worship today to talk more about this study or to learn more about starting up a new house group or small group Bible study in your neighborhood. I had a chat with a young adult who's interested in trying to start a lunch group that would meet together after lunch on Sundays in order to talk about the message and to talk about just the main takeaway from the sermon or from the music or the theme for the day. So that's something that is in the works. But if you are interested in hosting or if you got an idea for a weekly or a monthly group, then please let me know. But the Defying Gravity Bible study is going to tie into our September stewardship series. So we'll share more about that next week. And speaking of next week, you heard Jennifer mention the Chrysalis Boys Flight taking place here in our building next week. The participants and the volunteers will be utilizing several areas of our building, including the gym and the kitchen and the fellowship hall. They're going to be using the large bathrooms that we have on the east wing since they're handicap accessible and they have showers as well. So there's a lot of our space that's going to be used to host that important event. So next week, we ask that you please enter the building through this north lobby entrance, or you could also enter through the west entrance that's near the nursery. You can come in through the main entrance if you would like, but just be sure to hang a left and then come down the children's hall as you come to the sanctuary. But if you can, try to park in this west parking lot, coming through the north lobby entrance or through the west entrance near the nursery. Our donuts and our refreshments will be moved to will be moved out here to the north lobby for just 1 week since those boys and the volunteers are going to be utilizing the kitchen and the fellowship hall. So come to the north lobby. That's where all the snacks are going to be, all the treats, the donuts. The kids are going to be invited to hang out in room one. I saw a few of them playing billiards, which, I mean, when I was that age, was like throwing the cue ball down to one end and seeing it bounce back. So we'll see. Maybe we can teach the kids how to play billiards, or we'll bring like a Nintendo Switch and hook it up to the 80-inch TV that's in there, and they can play Mario Kart instead of running around the gym like they like to do. But next weekend is also Labor Day weekend. It also means that's the start of college football season. And so one of our traditions here at Peachtree is to encourage everybody to wear their team colors on Labor Day weekend for what we call Tailgate Sunday. So show us which college or university or a pro team that you love the most. Are you going to be wearing a soccer jersey this year, Tim? Do you know? Do you already have that? It's certainly possible. The other football. So come in your gear. We've had a lot of Volunteers fans. We've had a lot of Ole Miss fans. We have a lot of Memphis Tigers fans that are here in this congregation. So let's see which fan base it will be the greatest supported next week. And instead of a typical worship service that that includes a message preached by me. We're going to be filling the service with our favorite hymns and praise songs. You can text your request to the number that's on the screen. We're going to have a special children's moment during the service, maybe even teach our kids one of our favorite songs for them. And I believe we're also celebrating a baptism next week as well. So be sure to come back next week or tune in online for our tailgate Sunday, a hymn sing with a children's moment and an infant baptism that's all taking place next week. And now, will you pray with me? Dear God, we thank you so much for this day, to be able to gather here in person, to be able to gather online, to prepare our hearts and our minds to receive Holy Communion. We ask that you would be with us now as we wrap up our Dare to Dream series, as you help us in crafting our life mission statement, as we think about the purpose that you've given to us and the ways in which we might live that out, not just this school year, but throughout our entire lives. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, friends, we're at the end of our Dare to Dream series. We've established that everyone has a BHAG. Everyone has a BHAG, a big, hairy, audacious God purpose. And the way to center in on what our God purpose or our God dream in life mission is for our lives, the best way to center in on that is to identify the problems around us while also identifying the gifts of our head, our hands, and our heart. So that's what we've talked about over the last 3 weeks. And I pray that you've been able to discover the places where your gifts and the needs of our community intersect, where the needs of the community and your gifts intersect, because that will help you to begin the process of crafting a life mission statement. It'll normally involve a verb, right? This is something actionable, something that we will do. It's also going to include the resources that you have. What's in your hand? That's what we talked about with Moses. He had a staff, and yet it was more than a staff. God was able to do something extraordinary through something that seemed ordinary. What resources are at your disposal? What's something that you could begin doing right now? It doesn't take planning. It's just something that you can start doing right now. Your big, hairy, audacious God purpose can be found where the needs of our community intersect with the gifts of your head, hand, and heart. And when you start to figure out, you say, well, this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to serve these people. I'm going to volunteer my time in this place. I'm going to teach the next generation. I'm going to help veterans who are in need. I'm going to support international missions. I'm going to help rescue women and children out of poverty. Whatever it is that you say you're going to do, and maybe you can even get it down to one sentence to say that this is my mission, this is my purpose. Once you formed that, it doesn't mean that things are going to come easily. It doesn't mean that you're going to have a walk in the park. Because Moses didn't have a walk in the park. Jacob didn't have a walk in the park, nor did Abraham and Sarah, Joseph and Mary. Jesus didn't have a walk in the park. It's not going to come easily just because you have determined what your life mission is, what your purpose is. We will need something to sustain us as we face obstacles, as we overcome challenges, as we press forward. We're going to need something to sustain us, and that something is vision. Vision. We even see Jesus discuss the importance of vision in Matthew's gospel in chapter 6. This is what it says. The eye is the lamp of the body. So if your eye is healthy, your whole body will be full of light. But if your eye is unhealthy, your whole body will be full of darkness. If then the light in you is darkness, how great is the darkness? This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. So when he's talking about the eye of the body, I believe he's also talking about your vision. Your vision statement, your mission statement, your God purpose. A vision that will sustain you as you tackle all of these things. We need a vision that sustains, and we need to be sure that the vision that we have comes from God. Part of our God purpose, or this God-sized dream for our lives, is envisioning God's preferred future. We talked a little bit about this last week. Not to see things as they are, but to see things as they will be. Not just to accept the status quo, but to be agents of change. And so as we look ahead, as we see a preferred future, what does it sound like? What does it feel like when you think about this future that God has in store for you? What is the vision that God is giving you right now? And the thing about vision is that we have to tend to it. We have to calibrate it. We have to focus and refocus. We have to keep our eyes on the prize. I don't know about you, but I wear corrective lenses. I remember when the first time I got eyeglasses, I think I was in third grade. I was 8 years old. The first time I got contact lenses, I was like 13. I was in eighth grade. I had the hard, rigid, gas-permeable contact lenses, not the soft lenses I have now. And the first week I wore them, they felt so weird on the inside of my eyelids. I walked around like this just so that they wouldn't touch my eyelids. And people thought, it's like, Roof, are you okay? Like, yeah, man, I got contacts. Don't I look cool now? I mean, wearing corrective lenses, having eyeglasses, even if you have perfect vision, there was a point in time where you had to do some sort of reading test at school. So if you've ever sat in that optometrist chair, you know what it's like. One or two. Okay, now three or four. Is three better? Is four? Is that clearer? Let me do this. Is that better? No. I don't know what's happening in those moments. But yeah, it's amazing when things come into focus, when my vision becomes better. And so for your life, how can you tune and calibrate and focus the vision that God has for you? Maybe you have been hearing something for some time. And hopefully this series, As We Dare to Dream, is helping you to understand your purpose, your mission, and now to have a sustaining vision that will guide you through the challenging times. It's easy to get distracted, by the way. See, that's the other thing about vision. It's easy to get distracted, to lose sight of what we're doing, to look away, to say, I'm just going to keep it in my periphery over here. I can still see it, but I'm actually looking at this other thing. That's not the vision that will sustain me. That's not from God. So in the book that we've been referencing, that Dr. Durbin and I have used, Dare to Dream, Mike Slaughter, the author and the pastor, pointed to all the times that Moses would go to the top of a mountain to commune with God, and likewise how Jesus would spend time in prayer on the mountaintop. So Mike says, when you get tired of dealing with the obstacles, go to the mountains, talk to God, listen for his vision. Now, for some of you, it's actually mountains. For Kayla, it might be mountaintop, where she served this summer. For others of you, it's going to Lakeshore or Camp Sky Lake. For me, it would have been Asbury Hills or Lake Junaluska. I mean, there are physical mountains, geographical places where we can go, where we feel like we're just a little closer to the heavens. We're just a little higher up. We feel like we're a little closer to God. But those mountaintops don't just have to be in the mountains. You might have a trail that you like to walk. You might have a space in your home where you like to drink your coffee and read a devotional, or sit there with your Bible, or to sit there with your thoughts. And that might be your mountain. And so when the obstacles start to press in on you, go to the mountains and listen for God's vision. And as you begin to do this work, friends, remember to keep moving forward into God's preferred future. Author Robert Louis Stevenson once wrote that saints are sinners who kept on going. I love that idea. Because Lord knows I'm a sinner. But maybe if I just keep moving forward, if I just keep pressing forward into God's preferred future, if I keep my eye on the prize, if I remember what my big, hairy, audacious God purpose is, and I keep using my gifts to try to address the needs of my community, I might not do it every day. I might not do it perfectly. But if I keep moving forward, then maybe one day, my children, my grandchildren, the people that I love will say, yeah, he was a saint. Saints are sinners who kept on going. Keep at it. Continue seeking out God's vision for your life. Don't give up when the times get tough. Now, as I read through Mike's book, Dare to Dream, this month and observed how many challenges he faced being assigned to serve a rural congregation in Ohio as a 20-something, he went with his wife. He had gone from being an associate pastor, a youth minister at a large Methodist church where he had a large staff. He had lots of kids, hundreds of kids that were in that program. And then he became this pastor that could be assigned and sent anywhere. So they sent him to rural Ohio to a little two-room country chapel with maybe, I think it was like 20 or 40 people were still remaining members of the church. And he came in, he says, with jeans and long hair. It was him and his wife. And he had people that told him, it's like, we've been here long before you came, and we'll be here long after you leave. And he has been at that part of that church for, I think, over nearly 40 years now. He's now their pastor emeritus. He went out into the field, and he saw a vision. He felt he was receiving it from God of 3,000 people in worship. And at the time that he was serving this church, you know, the idea of a megachurch didn't really exist in our country. In Ohio, the largest Methodist church had about 1,500 in attendance. But he saw God giving him this vision of 3,000. And that's exactly where they're at. They have over 3,000 people that are part of Ginghamsburg United Methodist Church, multiple campuses, and they still own that original property. They still take young pastors there that are being trained up to serve churches, to plant new churches, and to go into areas and revitalize. They take them there so that they can see how far they've come. And as I was reading this, I was reminded of how we started as Peachtree. If you don't know, I was approached by Steve Stone Sr. I know Ed, we were talking about Steve Stone Sr. recently. He was one of your students. Well, he was a pastor at Heartsong Church. I think he was there for nearly 30 years himself. He planted that church. He's now helped to get a contemporary service started up at Germantown Methodist called Prism. But I was approached by Steve Stone Sr. when I was 28 years old, going on 29, to see if I'd be interested in learning more about church planting. Steve was serving as the Memphis Conference's Director of New Church Development. I was but a simple associate pastor at Carville UMC. And part of me thought it was crazy that the bishop and the bishop's cabinet would trust or believe in a 29-year-old to plant a new church, not just a new church, but a new type of church, a non-traditional church for new people, and to do so without a staff or a church building and with an operating budget of only $20,000. But almost 10 years later, here we are. And God gave me a vision for Peachtree. It's plastered on the walls of this building. You see it in every hashtag that we include when we post videos. You see it on our t-shirts. What is it? Church can happen anywhere. Church can happen anywhere. It's why we live stream. It's why we say hello to the friends that are worshiping with us right now, because they're as much a part of this church as you are who are sitting in this room, or somebody who catches this later or might discover our website or our Facebook page or our Instagram account and reads a piece of scripture or sees a prompt to pray for 60 seconds for the last person that they might have texted. It's because church can happen anywhere. And the church has needed to adapt in order to reach people in the world that we are living in right now. I hope you would agree. I think you do, or else you wouldn't be here. But we can continue to focus that vision. We can continue to calibrate it, one or two, three or four, so that we are reaching the most amount of people as possible across God's world. We can launch new groups. We can find new ways to help our neighbors encounter God in this world. So friends, as we wrap things up, as we prepare to move towards the table, I hope that you would remember as we leave this series, Dare to Dream, that God has created you for a purpose, that God has given you gifts of the head, of the hand, and of the heart to address the needs of this community, and that God will provide you with opportunities to encounter him on the mountain, wherever your mountain is, to sustain your vision so that you might persevere. Remember that God doesn't call the equipped. God equips the called. And God has called you. He's called you. I love the closing words from Mike's book. I think it's important for us to hear as we consider this idea of a sustaining vision, because we're going to need that if we're going to dream God-sized dreams. In moments of darkness, never doubt what God has promised you in the light. The darkness will come, the challenges will come, the obstacles will come. But if you would remember your purpose, if you would remember the gifts that God has so freely given you, and if you will pray for God to sustain your vision, then you'll be able to overcome each and every one of those as they increase in difficulty, as they come multiple challenges at a time. Because our God doesn't give up on us. And in moments of darkness, never doubt what God has promised you in the light. I thank you for journeying through this series with us. I pray if you missed a week that you'd go back and find one of the messages that Dr. Durbin or I preached. But as we go into this school year and beyond, I pray that you will have a life mission that will sustain you, whether you have 20 years left in your life, 15, 50, 80, the rest of your life, the rest of your time here on earth, to live out that purpose, to use your gifts, and to seek out God's vision. I pray it for you, and I pray it for me. In Jesus' name, amen. Friends, as we prepare to receive this gift of communion, I'd like to remind you that this is not Peace Tree's table. This is the Lord's table. And all are welcome here. My words will be on the screen in white. Your responses will be in yellow. But first, I invite you to hear this invitation. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us take a few moments to silently pray and confess our sins to God. Amen. Friends, hear this good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners, and that proves God's love toward us. In Jesus' name, we are all forgiven, and we give glory to God for that. Amen and amen. Now let us continue with the words of the great Thanksgiving. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, he gave thanks to you, he broke the bread, he gave it to his disciples, and he said, take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And when the supper was over, he took the cup, he gave thanks to you, he gave it to his disciples, and he said, drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us. As we proclaim the mystery of faith, Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on all of us gathered here, on all of our friends who are worshiping online at home, and pour out your Holy Spirit, God, on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. And now with the confidence of children of God, let us pray the prayer Jesus taught when he said, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. With those who will be assisting as communion service this morning, please come forward at this time, and our praise team can come back up to the stage as well. I believe, yeah, Jess, I see you, Jess. Leanna and Brooklyn. Y'all coming too? Jennifer, okay. Just because this is the first time we've done this in a while, folks, I want you to see we are sanitizing our hands. This is the first time that we have served elements in communion, communion elements on a Sunday morning since 2020. And so, friends, when you receive the bread, we're going to invite you to come with your hands cupped, and you'll have someone put the bread in your hands, and then you'll take that and dip it into the juice. If you would require a sealed one as well, then we have the sealed packets that we have been using. But right now, we'll serve these servers, and perhaps we'll serve the band after the worship concludes, Tim. The body of Christ broken for you. 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 The blood of Christ shed 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 for you. Okay. If you'll stand that direction. So friends, we're going to invite you to come from the back row first. You'll come, you'll receive the bread and then the juice, and then you'll return to your section by this aisle. This group can come up this section, receive the bread and then the juice, return by that, and then starting from the back row, receive the bread and then the juice, and then you'll return by that aisle. God's table is open. If you would require one of the sealed packets, or if you'd like for us to bring it to you, then please wave at me. If you'd like to come forward and not receive the elements, because we do not have gluten-free this month, you can also just come and simply cross your arms or come to find me and receive a blessing. But the table is open and all are welcome.
Bless the Lord, O my soul. Sing praise to Him and Him alone. Bless the Lord, O my soul. Sing praise.
Bow your heads and pray with me. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, and God's people said, Amen. Friends, we're going to invite you, if you can, to stand at this time. We've got one final song that we're going to be singing together as a congregation. I hope that as we do so, that you will remember that God has created you for a purpose, that there are needs out there, right? That we just pray this, that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. There are others who need us. There are others who need you and what you have to offer. Count the blessings of your head, your hand, and your heart. And when you think about your vision, when you think about the eye being the lamp of the body, I pray that you would consider your body filled with light, not with darkness, but with the light and the truth and the hope of Jesus Christ. So let's sing together the words of I Saw the Light. Amen. Our thanks to Mulberry Jam for joining our worship team this morning and for leading us. And friends, I hope that you will go out, that you will not concentrate on the darkness, that you will not concentrate on the obstacles or the challenges or the things of this world that just fall short. I pray that you will look for God's light. I pray that you will be the light. I pray that you will remember that the eye is the lamp of the body and that you are filled with God's light. You are filled with God's Spirit, hope, peace, and truth. So be the light to others. Remember the vision that will sustain you, and go change lives in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Go in peace. Amen.